Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with a spirit of openness and honesty and willingness, and we ask that you sit with us and be part of our conversation as we explore and talk about sometimes difficult issues. Be with us, sit with us, and encourage us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So what we would like to do today is to continue a discussion based on the last couple classes that were here about sanctuary. We would like to finally get to a point where we understand what this congregation wishes to do about the sanctuary. There are a number of things we can do, from nothing to a lot of things. Where do we sit as a congregation? We'd like to build towards asking those sorts of questions among, well, this group, first of all, and then to the wider group, eventually. So what we're going to do this morning is Emmeline's going to start and sort of give a recap of where we are, where we've been the last couple of weeks, and then we'll just open it up to discussion to try and understand your concerns, see where you have questions, see where you want to help, see where we can go as a church. So, Emmeline?
So I think most people in the room were at one of the last 2 weeks. So 2 weeks ago, I gave a little bit of an overview of what the sanctuary movement is, and sort of why Christian communities have been addressing it. And then I think last week, Marianne talked a little bit more about immigration issues in general and some of the more specifics of Washtenaw County. Is that accurate? Mm-hmm. Okay, so some of the stuff that we went over was just sort of why we have so many people crossing the border and the many different ways that that happens and how people end up staying in the country. And then some of the current concerns over returning to countries of origin, what that would mean for folks who have to do that, what kind of safety concerns there are, concerns about splitting up families, concerns for our community here, losing valuable members, and then why this has escalated. So I think an important point to make is that this is not an issue that was new under the Trump administration. Under the Obama administration, there were also, an uptick in deportations. But a lot of the tactics around deportation have changed. And then there have been escalations. I'm sure everyone's familiar with, families getting separated, parents being deported, and their children being handed over to be adopted by American families without the consent of the families, things like that. So that's sort of why sanctuary has really gained a little bit more prominence and publicity. But it's been an ongoing conversation for a while to sort of have various tactics in the hands of advocates who are trying to make sure that, in a system that is broken and is extremely difficult to navigate and is often administered very differently depending on what county you're in or, what kind of lawyer you can afford, just trying to make sure that we are making sure everyone gets a fair shake. It's been a tactic for a while to have the option of putting a person to sanctuary to buy time, to, get a little bit more publicity around their case, that sort of thing. Were there any just questions about what sanctuary is after the last 2 weeks, or burning clarifications that are needed?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Both you and Marianne talked about the various levels of support that a church could give to sanctuary, mm-hmm. and one of the levels, short of embracing someone actually taking sanctuary, is that a church could give support to other
yes.
churches.
Yeah.
That was never really elaborated upon. What would that entail?
I still can't pull up this PowerPoint for some reason.
But basically, there are three levels of support. So Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary, I'll back up and explain, is the sort of organizing agent in Washtenaw County around this issue. So they've been collecting money, doing education and advocacy. So Marianne Perron, who was here last week, is with Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary. They've been doing their legal research, building support, that sort of thing, for if a family would need to go into sanctuary. They work really closely with WICR, which is Washtenaw Interfaith Coalition for Immigrants' Rights, who has the most contact with immigrant families in Washtenaw County and is the one sort of hearing their concerns and helping them with their legal issues, helping to get them connected with the right people for various legal issues. So Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary, what they sort of do is they help determine with family if this is the appropriate step. If they've exhausted every other option, their legal appeals are not getting them anywhere, and they have a major concern of returning, they'll identify a congregation that has agreed to take a family in, and then they coordinate any other logistical support. So if somebody goes into sanctuary, there's a need for volunteers to do grocery shopping, to socialize, to come and visit with the people in sanctuary who can't leave the building, to assist with laundry if the congregation that's hosting somebody doesn't have a laundry facility. You know, there are just a number of different ways in which the community needs support, and especially if it's a smaller congregation that doesn't have enough folks who can volunteer. Other congregations can offer volunteers. So that's sort of the support level. And it wouldn't have to be, you know, the entire Zion congregation, but if there was a little team of people at Zion who wanted to support somebody in sanctuary at another congregation, those are sort of the different types of things that they would do. They could support, you know, certainly continue to support education and advocacy, but could do laundry, could bring groceries. You know, if there's somebody who has like a medical expertise and, you know, go and do a checkup on the folks who can't leave and go to the doctor, the different things like that.
I'm sure they could use money.
Yeah, so that's level three of support, is just money. And there have been some questions around, you know, so right now, Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary has been collecting funds. The Interfaith Council for Peace and Justice is the fiduciary agent, so it's holding that money. Very little of that money is currently being spent, like a very small amount on the education and advocacy and that sort of thing, but really that money is being held for if a family were to go into sanctuary, the cost would not, that burden would not fall on the congregation that's hosting them. Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary would be using the funds that is gathered from other congregations, from individuals and so on, to help cover the cost of that family so that it's not just a burden on that church. So that is still a way to publicly give support as a congregation, or privately as an individual or whatever. You can support Congregational Sanctuary financially. We are following up to ask if, let's say, 5 years from now, you know, we haven't had a family in Washtenaw County go into sanctuary, what would happen to that money? Would it be given to another immigration-related cause? Would it go to the Interfaith Council for Peace and Justice? I don't have an answer to that right now, but we can definitely find that out. Oh, are you?
No.
No, you have a question.
Okay. I have a question. Are there numbers? Are there people seeking sanctuary? Do we know how many there are in the area?
So there is one family in Detroit and one in Kalamazoo. Those are the only families in Michigan that
I'm in sanctuary.
Yes, we're actually in sanctuary right now.
But there's no waiting list of people standing at the...
No.
Washtenaw border.
No. It's very much an act of last resort. And people who would go into sanctuary are all people who are trying to undergo legal proceedings. It's never, you know, someone who's trying to skirt the system. It's people who are really actively trying to work with the system, but when their appeals are not being heard and they are not getting justice and they have a real fear of returning to their home country. So that's where it's a conversation with Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary of, is this actually the right move? Is there any chance? Because if there's no chance that they're going to be able to stay, then putting them in a church for 6 months or a year is maybe not worth it. But if having an extra month or two with family is worth it, then maybe that's part of the conversation. If, you know, over the course of 3 months, there's going to get some more publicity around the issue, or they're going to have the opportunity to build a stronger legal argument, then that can be worth it. But it really, really is an act of last resort. So that's why we have not had families knocking down the door to go into sanctuary, because, I mean, nobody wants to do that. It's a really big decision to give up that amount of independence. And
right. Yeah. So, and there are three churches in Washtenaw County that currently have committed to the highest level.
Yes,
what,
that is
what
right.
Churches are those?
Unitarian Universalist.
Yeah,
Beth Emmett. Genesis and, yeah, like that.
Oh, St. Clair's and Church of the Good Shepherd.
And Church of the Good Shepherd, I think. And then there are an additional 9 congregations that have either given public financial support or pledged volunteer support were another congregation to take somebody in. I think some of those congregations are still working on, like, making sure the facility could meet the needs of a family in sanctuary, and again, since it hasn't been vital, we would have lead up time. If there really was a family that was considering it, there would be some time to make preparation.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that Unitarian Universalist has like made a sort of makeshift shower situation and stuff like that. So I think they were the first ones to sign up.
Church of the Shepherd is on Independence, just off of Packard.
Oh, it's still yeah. Church.
Like a quarter of a mile off of Packard.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
UCC?
Yeah, they're UCC.
Yeah.
Congregation.
Mm-hmm.
But so that's sort of where Congregational Sanctuary sits right now in our county. But so part of the value, I think, in it is the public showing of support. And it provides a certain level of comfort to Emory communities to know that there are congregations who will defend them or help work with them to find solutions. And it strengthens the movement overall just to have buy-in from various congregations in the area. So that's where, you know, yeah, the question of whether or not any congregation in Washington County is really likely to house someone is kind of low. But it's really much better to be prepared early than to be scrambling. And there's just value in the conversation happening within our congregation, within our community. Yeah.
So I didn't realize, you said before when you gave your talk that this was always an act of last resort, that, you know, that it was when everything else was exhausted. Is it still looked upon as being a stopgap measure? I mean, it's not the sort of thing where somebody, you know, a family goes into a church and says, well, we may be here for 5 or 6 years or something like that.
Yeah,
right?
That would not be considered like a sustainable option.
Yeah.
And each congregation, when they make the decision to become a sanctuary congregation, can put whatever, you know, parameters or stipulations. So say every 2 months we're going to check in and make sure that this is still the right way to move forward. Or, you know, put an overall limit of a year and a half. A year and a half, this is just not going anywhere. You know, like those are options. But you could also say, if you need to stay here 5 years, you can stay here 5 years. But I don't think that that's a, you know, favorable option for anybody. So I've never encountered in Washoe Congregational Sanctuary that being the conversation.
My understanding was that it was to prevent the individuals that were in the legal system from being deported prematurely.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, so
would a legal system take 5 years?
You would really hope not, but it's been pretty bad. So that's where just right now, I mean, there are tons of backups.
I've heard that the judges have actually made the next court date in 2020.
Oh my.
So you go in for a hearing and then the judge says, okay, how about February of 2020? And the lawyer says, yeah, I think I'm clear then.
Okay, I had
but of
no
course,
idea.
This is somebody with
that.
A deportation order, though. You know, like this would be somebody
right.
really facing deportation,
right.
but felt like they haven't really gotten to give their case, that there are, you know, extraneous circumstances that should allow them to stay, that sort of thing. So
once you get a deportation order, are you usually put on a tether of some kind? Do you know what happens?
I think it varies.
Okay.
The level of surveillance. I mean, again, and also like this administration does some things differently. I don't want to answer that question correctly. I'm not sure.
I just wondered how that worked, you know, for people.
I mean, you're supposed to check in regularly and all that and let them know when you're leaving and show that you've purchased a ticket and that sort of thing.
We think a lot of people would just try to disappear if they have an option.
I think some people do, but that's also, you don't want to live your life like that.
Right.
So that's where people would rather go into sanctuary temporarily to try to find a permanent solution.
So has council talked about this at all?
No.
So that's where today, if I can kind of jump then into the next thing, we're hoping to kind of get an understanding of what folks think we could do. Option number one is do nothing. Like, this has been a great 3 weeks and we don't talk about it anymore. We could continue to educate the congregation and continue to talk about these issues. We could discuss, and you know, none of these are mutually exclusive, discuss potentially being a host, potentially giving support, or giving financially. You know, there are a lot of different, yeah.
The reason I asked the numbers question is I think people aren't going to feel the crunch about this until the whole process opens up, and then we have an administration that says, yes, we're taking in immigrants, and, you know, people need to feel that there are people knocking on the door, coming. Mm-hmm. You know, they know it's down there. They know it's at the Guatemala-Mexico border, you know, this busload that's coming, that's sneaking in. But people don't have the feeling it's impacting them right here. So it's all theoretical, you know.
You so know, part of the educational piece of it will be increasing the understanding and awareness of why are people running out of Guatemala? Yeah,
why are
people leaving the Latin American countries? And what is the United States' role in that? What did we do as a country to create some of those situations?
Yes.
I mean, all this education is, depending on which news source you listen to, it's either we're either the bad guys or the good guys.
I think, too.
1954, we almost threw a president. Legitimate elected government. Shut that.
I think too.
Nothing like that except that ever since.
Yeah. Maybe we need a history lesson here.
Well, that's the educational piece.
I think through education I've come to see that while I've come to see that there are different levels. And by joining in a Zion Lutheran Church, we make a statement. And a statement is important, I think, for our community. So if we could get the congregation, although there's no urgency.
No, there isn't. That's why nobody's here.
Yeah. Is making a statement worthwhile to us as a congregation? And I think that's one of the issues that people need to address. Because we may not choose to be an actual living place for people, but again, I think collaborating with other churches is something I'd like to personally like to see us do.
So, you know, it seems like the conversation gets quickly convoluted between sanctuary congregations and efforts to talk about that and support it in one form or another versus U.S. immigration and refugee issues in general. And I thought, and correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, our conversation was largely around sanctuary congregation. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I sort of get worried a little bit as the conversation strays towards sort of solving U.S. immigration policy. I understand that there might be some linkages between those, but, you know, so I guess I would throw the question back and ask, you know, is the conversation really about sanctuary congregation and what it would mean for our church to actually take a position on that one way or another? Or is it broader than that?
Well, and I think, I agree we get into trouble when we start. It becomes political. And while we can educate people who want to be educated on that, to address the whole congregation who has some different views than probably most of us sitting here, but I think we risk becoming too political.
So part of the reason, and I think I mentioned this two or three weeks ago, you know, if we look at what I think of as an analogy, maybe not a great one, but an analogy of trying to address poverty, we understand that there's lots of, you know, ways people get into poverty, but it doesn't necessarily stop our congregation for actually helping those who are in poverty. Hmm. And so if in fact that's a fair analogy, you know, sanctuary congregation seems to me to be an overt statement about helping people or supporting people who might need sanctuary congregational support. Mm-hmm. And so if that's true, regardless of how those people end up in situations that where they have that need, mm-hmm. it still begs the question, are we in support of, you know, you know, congregations stepping forward and helping those who need sanctuary congregations, regardless of what, at what level.
And I appreciate what you're saying on one hand, but on the other hand, it concerns me that if we as a congregation are always simply focused on charity and not on justice, we're not fulfilling our calling to be the church. So if it's all about, you know, let's just help out this poor person who's in trouble and we'll help them do their laundry and things like that. But, oh my gosh, we cannot and we will not go into the justice of why this person is in this predicament, why people are fleeing these countries. I fear that we're not living up to our full calling either. So I understand what you're saying, that you can get so broad so quickly that you're of no good to anyone. But on the other hand, I would hate, you know, there's this great quote we've got on our wall at home is, when I give food to the poor, they call me a saint. When I ask why the poor have no food, they call me a communist. It's that, I think, that I don't want to get lost. So that, to me, is
that is part of this advocacy component. And so I do understand that there's a role to be played there, but it's sort of at a more tangible level is really this more overt statement about do we or do we not, as a congregation, support, you know, individuals who find themselves in need of sanctuary? Mm-hmm. And if so, at what level?
I mean, it's almost like looking at it as a step. I mean, I think you sort of, if you tie them together and we make the issue too broad, we risk everybody just stepping out completely. And so, you know, we sort of end up doing this a lot. You know, you don't really take this full step that you'd like to take, but you take a step that direction, which then, okay, maybe we can work a little bit more on the education to actually be able to move the next step.
Well, do we know what the ELCA has done with sanctuary?
You did some research that there was at least one congregation.
There was the synod, the whole synod in, Oregon, I think. Yeah, the whole synod became a sanctuary synod and voted on at their assembly and so on. Now, I don't recall what I found at the ELCA site in particular about this.
That's something we could follow.
Yeah, what is their language?
Yeah, what's their language? Now, they try to be apolitical, I mean, but more geared toward justice. And so I think that's one thing we should do. But you know, we have the whole political series that we had, we really tried to be apolitical, nonpartisan. And I think we accomplished that. But people, if we'd gone towards one side or the other, I think people would have been turned off, and I think people did not come if they felt they just didn't come to that series if they felt it was going to be political or they're of a different bent. So it's kind of a choice then, and maybe the reason why people are needing sanctuary is an educational series, much like we've done for the Palestinian cause. And you know, we've done a lot that maybe could have been viewed as political in that whole effort. So maybe this can be viewed similarly.
So one of my follow-up questions then is, what is the education that we feel the congregation needs? So, you know, we've discussed a little bit, like, what are those root causes? Why is it dangerous to send people back to countries of origin? Is that something that would be valuable to talk about, instability in Latin America? Or is that really not so much priority? Like, I would just like to know what it is.
I think people don't have an understanding of that. I don't think I have a full understanding of that. I don't know the history. And so there'd be a lot of education that I'd be able to gain out of a class or two on those kinds of things. And Latin America is not the only country that we probably need to think about in terms of retribution if they're sent home.
Right.
again, just a quick Google search, you know, there's several ELCA synods that have taken positions on being a sanctuary synod.
Mm-hmm.
I can't find any in Michigan, but, you know, certainly in other parts of the country, in New England, and somewhere in the southwest corner of the United States, there are sanctuary synods.
Yeah.
But,
well, I know that Michigan's synod is not one. That's Southeast Michigan.
So if Zion were to take an affirmative action of some kind on this issue, it's conceivable that we might also approach the Synod to see about and take some leadership with the Synod in moving the Synod toward some formal action as well. We could be a catalyst or something of a leader in Southeast Michigan if we chose to be.
I think the other thing that, again, I applaud the effort to try to have engage these conversations is that it does prepare myself, I think it prepares the congregation to have a deeper understanding of what it means to say that we support, you know, a sanctuary congregation or be a supportive, you know, entity in that regard. Because not knowing sort of what the specific needs are, because to Sonia's point, we don't have a queue, if you will, of people, it would be good to sort of walk into that with our eyes wide open.
Mm-hmm.
And so having some sense as to what those needs could be, you know, I think is you know, really could be quite profound. Because again, it's easy to say that we would support it, but if it doesn't demand anything of us other than writing a piece of paper, then I think it's good to sort of have a deeper understanding of, you know, should something change tomorrow, then we do so. We make that commitment with our eyes wide open.
And that's where I think Zion taking some type of stance, whether it's a level, you know, 3-2-1 on this issue, like some of the concerns about this issue being too political are because of the perception of it as mm-hmm. a partisan issue. But the more that various congregations step up and say, we want to engage with this, and yes, we still have questions, and yes, we still have, you know, people in our congregation who feel different ways, it normalizes this as a non-partisan issue of, you know, family separation, of unfair deportation, of all these different, you know, issues surrounding immigration right now. So that's where I see a lot of value. And I will say, particularly in Zion, who's not one of the typical congregations stepping up on issues like this. So like the other congregations that have very publicly made support are United Church of Christ or Unitarian Universalists or, you know,
Quakers,
mm-hmm. you know, Reformed Jews.
Yeah.
So I think that that's where we could actually really bring more attention to this issue in the overall community, because a congregation that is careful about being political is saying this is not a political issue, this is a humanitarian issue mm-hmm. that we want to make sure we're discussing.
Well, I think for so many, I mean, I have to apologize, I missed the last 2 weeks, but I think for the general congregation who probably wasn't coming, they still don't really understand what sanctuary is and who would be considered going into sanctuary.
I think we would need education from the pulpit. Because this is never going to educate the congregation.
Mm-hmm. Not this little group,
no. So I don't see any other way to reach the congregation, really. An article in the Tower is not going to do it. And inviting people to adult ed is going to get you a dozen people.
Unless you get some really pretty high-powered speaker.
Either our ministers or somebody. But it can't be totally political. Particular situations,
yeah.
Like a Catholic priest talking about the family at St. Mary's that got torn apart, or
mm-hmm.
Personalize it with a guest preacher like that. I know mm-hmm. St. Mary's went through this in the last year with having a family mm-hmm. Member deported and a family left behind.
I think we need to get people involved in this. I don't know if the pulpit certainly is an option, but if it's something that the congregation understands that the council's considering, and the council's considering a vote on it, all of a sudden there's going to be a lot.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Yeah. That's actually really
good. And you will have, I mean, just an education hour, it doesn't matter what the topic is, we don't get pretty good attendance at education hour, because mm-hmm. mm-hmm. it's just viewed as, you know, another thing to look at or nothing on. But if it's actually something where the church is taking a firm position on, then all of a sudden people show up.
It's a good parallel right now is that LGBTQ task force that we have going right now, they've been looking at that issue for a year or something and slowly bringing forth information to congregation, and people are starting to understand that, you know, that this is an issue that, that there's people concerned about, and it's going to come to council and to the congregation, and ultimately we're going to make a decision on that. This could be a very similar sort of situation.
And part of that is exactly what that group is doing. It formed a task force, and that task force is going about a very methodological system. Part of that is sharing personal stories. Part of that is education. Part of that will be a council vote. So if this council, if this church wanted to create a statement, a welcoming statement, if you will, for sanctuary statement or whatever you want to call the thing, council would approve that, and then I don't know, would we need to approve donating money to these organizations, or is that a decision the Mission Corps could do all by themselves?
Well, we have, but I guess that's coming under question, how much money we'll have and what authority we'll have too.
You mean so congregational sanctuary?
For sanctuary?
No,
just in general.
Where our money-making decisions, I understand, they're sometimes questioned now. That we have decision-making power over.
Education is such an important part of that. If you donate to a sanctuary congregation without people understanding what it is,
right,
it'll be very polarizing. Because I can tell you coming into these meetings, these have been very interesting and enlightening, because I don't think 90%, and I'm going to generalize, but I'm going to say 90% of the population would know the difference between, other than the magnitude, between a sanctuary state, a sanctuary city, a sanctuary county, and a sanctuary congregation, right?
Yeah.
And they, and you know, especially at the highest level, many of you will view it as, well, a sanctuary state is just a place where they're protecting for any reason, and, you know, and they don't care what the law says, they're doing their own thing, and as you peel the onion back, and you truly understand what is trying to be accomplished by a sanctuary congregation, it's almost 180-degree different view, and it's a very personal level, as opposed to a much more political level.
Well, typically, if Mission Corps gives money to something, we have a kind of educational Sunday. We put a bulletin insert in. We have a table up with information. And most people don't read it. Don't.
Well, and that's where I think that's why this is a little bit different is if we were to give money as a congregation, Washtenaw Congregational Sanctuary would put us on the list.
Right.
Of supporting congregations. We'd be a public
support.
And that's the issue that I think the church-wide needs. I don't think the council cares how you, if you give money to sanctuary, fine. It doesn't really matter. Okay. But if we put Zion's name on the website that supports this, that's a reflection on the entire congregation, and I think we need to carefully think about that.
You know, we do have money in the refugee fund. I don't know how much it is. You might know, Emmy, but
I think it's like $9,000 or something, right?
$9,000.
But that money is, so that's where also,
well,
yeah.
You know, I don't remember what all the criteria were and so on, but it's refugees. It's people who need things in an emergent situation, which is what part of the criteria, one of the criteria.
So again, unless there are some numbers, you know, around which to define, you know, what would it take to actually do the financial support? I mean, so to some degree, I suspect that you would need to put a little meat to that bone to say that, you know, if in fact it costs X number of dollars to support a family of four, you know, for sanctuary for, I don't know, a week, a month, 6 months, something like that. because again, you know, my concern is that, yeah, you know, there's sort of an immediate need as soon as a family goes into sanctuary, and there's going to be a short-term need to fill, you know, both physically, emotionally, and financially. Could we have been a part of that? Sure. And maybe the $9,000 is a good start. But, you know, at the same point in time, you know, I think it's unlikely that Zion's going to set aside $100,000, you know, to do nothing if, in fact, we never populate, you know, a single congregation within our county. So, you know, so some of this, you know, I think I would just be cautious about, you know, sort of doing one or the other, but actually educate people as to what would it take, should it we need to financially support a family of or families, you know, so that in fact we again go into this situation with our eyes wide open. Mm-hmm. And that way we don't have to do either. We have to have a short-term pot of money, and whether it comes out of Mission Corps budget or it comes out of some, you know, the refugee budget, I mean, those are details that council or Mission Corps can work out easily. But behind it is some sort of pledge that says, you know, we're going to try to step forward and actually fill this additional void, knowing what that void would be.
But I mean, we would not be the only congregation.
Of course, right? Yeah. I didn't say we had to solve it ourselves. Yeah.
Two different sort of points. We've had like a refugee team at Zion that has not been super active because there has not been refugee resettlement going on. I mean, the administration, it looks like, is going to settle less than 30,000 this year.
Nationwide.
Whereas we were initially planning for 100 and then switched that to 50, and now it's like 100. So there's not a lot of action going on there. We've had other conversations around immigration issues, so I'm wondering if, you know, we've had sort of teams in the past that have gone by the wayside, but if we were to create a task force again around immigrant support, and then sort of right now the relevant issue is congregational sanctuary, that's something that there's a concern there's going to be an uptick in a need for. And again, we can try to get, yeah, more of those details. Would that be sort of a good next step to sort of build that task force team within the congregation?
Well, what's the process of taking it to council? What do you need in order to ask council to agree to a statement?
Well, I think, I don't know exactly the answer to your question, but maybe council should be the one to appoint if we're going to have a task force. Maybe it ought to come from council to start, so that they're aware, and then they go through the process kind of like the Reconciling in Christ team did.
A couple people that are on council, was there, part of me thinks that their council did take some action on this in the past, or has discussed it in the past. Is this ringing any bells, that this issue had been broached at the council level?
I don't remember saying so.
I don't think so.
I don't recall it.
Okay.
I have an observation to make. Thinking about, I think education is really important. I don't know if you're going to get the pastors out in front of this or not, because they're very sensitive to political issues. But here's my thought, and I suspect that there are people who are going to be opposed to this, and I think their opposition is going to come not from the fact that they oppose helping people who need help, but that they see these people who are here who need sanctuary as breaking the law. Mm-hmm. And I think that if you're going to sell this to those people, I think what you need to stress is, that is in terms of education, sanctuary is about helping people who are in the political process trying to do the right thing.
Or the legal process.
Trying to do the right thing. Because I think that the misperception here is that people are taking sanctuary in order to avoid the legal process and undercutting the legal system. And if you were to stress that what we're trying to do is to help these people get justice or go through the legal process, I think that's going to be a much easier sell than just to say, you know, we need to help these people because there in sanctuary. I think you need to stress that, that this, we're trying to help these people do the right thing legally, regardless of how that turns out. They may wind up being deported, but what we want to do is we want to see them through the legal process. And I think if you do that, it's going to be a much easier sell than if you just try to say, we want to support these people.
Well, I think what, you know, speaking over the last couple of weeks, was a little bit of what's missing, we haven't talked about it, what is the process for someone to qualify as into the system, right?
Yeah, we
have to
touch
What is the qualification because for those 30,000 families that will actually...
Well, not even, because that's...
Well, that's refugees. That's different.
That's for the people who want to be, or decide, say, yes, I want to be in, you know, a sanctuary congregation, or protection of sanctuary congregation. What, there's got to be a selection process.
Yeah, and we...
It's not up to the individual.
Yeah, and so it's a conversation with Washoe Congregational Sanctuary. So they'll be working with the family all throughout. And then when it gets to that point of, okay, let's talk about if this is actually a viable option. Yeah, I can...
But it would be good to know.
Yeah, someone from Wicker to come.
The point that brought up of saying, yes, the reason they're accept, one of the reasons or the criteria is that they are in the system and working through the legal process and, you know, trying to get a legal resolution without being in that process. Is someone even eligible? I don't know.
So that's where we can come back to the question of what is the education that we still need. So that's definitely one. We need somebody from Washington Congregational Sanctuary to come and say, this is the conversation that I would have with the family, and we would go through these questions and criteria.
But then who also makes that decision?
Yeah. We want some background information on why people are coming and why they fear returning. And I feel like there's one other thing I jotted down.
Well, and the people are trying to use the legal system.
Okay, so those are the things that we feel like we need to prioritize in terms.
And if we were giving financial support, what are the
what level?
What's needed to support a family or an individual for X period of time under this circumstance? Okay. Who the other congregations are? I think if we get some resolutions from other congregations that have made this decision.
I think that maybe another piece of education would have another congregation that's gone through this process. And we've had that before. We had a session upstairs where somebody from First Methodist in Ann Arbor came, their sanctuary congregation that's level two support. They came and spoke about how they went through the process and ended up voting as a congregation, all that. So that could be beneficial. Mm-hmm. And maybe, we can see if we can get a speaker from who's had some sort of interaction with a family that actually has gone into sanctuary and why they went into sanctuary and
or St. Mary's.
About the family being, they decided not to pursue sanctuary, and I think it was the father was
The father was deported, and the mother and children are here.
So let me ask you a very practical question about this. As you think about undertaking, as we think about undertaking educating the congregation, what is the best forum for that?
Yeah.
Is it a Sunday morning like this, or is it, would something like this be better held on a weekend night or on a weekend or something like that? I'm just asking because, when the adult education thinks about scheduling classes, should we be involved in this? Or, I'm not going to take offense one way or the other. I'm just curious, what do you think is the best venue for doing this?
I suspect if we do it on a Sunday morning like this, this is the group of people that will come.
This is it,
And the other voices won't be heard.
Mm-hmm. But do you think they'll come at a different time either?
No, not really.
But if we started putting bulletin inserts or we started
I think you need to, before we have some, I think you start out small. And the bulletin inserts, we've gotten a lot of compliments on those bulletin inserts as sort of like generating some questions and answers for people who have no idea what this is about, and sort of I think they're going to be ready when the time comes. So I'd start out like that, because I think it just raises awareness in a quiet sort of way. And you can, some of those topics you mentioned there could be bulletin inserts.
Yeah, we could answer some of those legal questions and that sort of thing
Yeah.
This is somebody working in the legal process. Being a sanctuary congregation is not, it's an act of civil disobedience, but it is not illegal, things like that.
Yeah, it's helping them work through the legal system.
Mm-hmm.
And things like that, I think,
yeah,
might
I
be the best way to start.
Yeah.
And then we might be able to have more attendance at a Sunday morning event at some point.
Where there'd be discussion, I mean, because...
Yeah, where people can continue to ask questions.
Because sometimes people... Before or after some council push that would make it more urgency, because I heard people saying that it's only when council raises it as an issue that people want to be informed.
Well, I personally would like to see council appoint a task force to say, we acknowledge this is an issue,
mm-hmm.
and we want some direction on it.
So
and
I think that needs to precede the education so that
yeah.
people
yeah.
see
right.
that it's moving forward,
yeah.
and I better get some education on
mm-hmm.
it. If
and
I
if there are
opinion.
Some parameters they want to put around it, well, great.
Mm-hmm.
What is a task force going to do that hasn't already been done?
I think they figure out ways to educate the congregation. They figure out what, they make themselves knowledgeable about the various levels. I think they connect with the county groups and work to educate the congregation over time and eventually have a statement that can go before council.
I sort of feel that that's already been done.
Well, but as much as anything, it's like what
no.
Mike was saying, and that is once council gets moving on this, people realize, wow, something's happening here, and I got to get
yeah.
informed.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
as much as anything,
yeah.
it's a statement.
I don't think that's been done at
yeah.
all.
And if the task force starts off by writing a statement that the council
okay.
can
yeah.
prove,
okay.
then that is a good first step to legitimizing, if
okay.
you will,
yeah.
a task force.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's important to make the congregation want to attend the educational format.
And I'll just throw out one other thing, that since we've already sort of approved having refugee-based conversations, that maybe we could ask the Maritas to come back
yeah.
and talk about unaccompanied minors who are mostly coming out of Latin America. So even though we don't have people labeled refugee out of Latin America, maybe we could get a little more education around why people are leaving Guatemala, Honduras.
And Samaritas is a very credible source
yeah.
for this congregation, too. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Yeah, I think the key, if you decide to have subsequent educational meetings, either in the evening or on the weekends or something, you need to get some
yeah.
good speakers,
yes.
you know, that outside of the congregation that have a little bit, because Zion loves people that have authority, you know, some sort of authority in a subject or something like
yeah.
that. So,
can give you the
again, my only cautionary note is really to try to be laser focused on what you see are the most tangible objectives. And that, you know, while I understand and echo in many ways Brian's comments that we want to talk about sort of this advocacy component, and as important as that might be to the long-term, you know, kind of interaction that we would have, I still think that there's a more immediate sort of decision related around, you know, a statement about who we are and what our relationship would be to be involved in sanctuary congregations.
Mm-hmm.
And my concern is that the other one is such a big ocean of topics that we could spend the next decade of educational opportunities to sort of focus on those kinds of things and never get to ask the question as to whether, in fact, we want to be a sanctuary congregation.
Yeah.
And my hope would be that if we were to take that step, then the congregation would need to prepare itself to defend that step, and that
yeah.
would create more advocates within the congregation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Great, I think
thank
we
you,
next
everyone. Very helpful.